Thank you, everyone, for joining today. Today we have Dr. Jason Goldstein, the VP of Research and Development from AdiPoint Biotechnology, and today he will be speaking about the application of ClonePic and CloneSelect technologies for improved hybridoma discovery. All callers have been placed on mute. At the end, we will host a question and answer session. Please submit your written questions using the Q&A tab on the right-hand side of your WebEx, and we will answer them accordingly. I now present to you Dr. Jason Goldstein.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak here today. I want to give you a little bit of background about AdiPoint Biotechnology before beginning the talk. AdiPoint is a discovery in CRO biotechnology company focused on novel monoclonal antibodies that target inflammation and infectious disease indications. We provide clients with customized monoclonals to assist in their transition from benchtop discoveries into preclinical development. AdiPoint develops affordable panels of monoclonals to enhance client success with novel assay design and in vitro diagnostic prototypes. So, in the application of ClonePic and CloneSelect technologies for improved hybridoma discovery, we focused on two different topics to talk about today. ClonePic and CSI technologies were employed in these two discovery projects requiring monoclonal antibodies with specific requirements. For the hybridoma recloning project, we assessed IgG secretion using ClonePic as well as colony growth rates with the CloneSelect imager. Together, they were critical for producing a monoclonal towards a specific strain, a single-stranded DNA virus. In vitro diagnostic development relied on this monoclonal for accurate serological detection of species within a family of viruses. Rescue of a historically low-producing clone was achieved through isolation of stable clones, which in turn translated into greater IgG yields. ClonePic and CSI technologies decreased the production timeline and improved the secretion of hybridoma subclones, greatly impacting downstream assay development. In our second project, I'll focus on the development of novel monoclonals to a bacterial chaperone, which is a member of the dead T protein family. The detection of this antigen in human serum is critical given its role in chronic inflammation associated with several types of bacterial pathogens. The discovery of high affinity and antigen-specific IgGs was achieved through screening fusion material with the ClonePic FL system. These reagents have proven invaluable during assay and diagnostic development for detection of these biomarkers early in the infection. So double-stranded DNA viruses cause a variety of diseases in humans with closely related symptoms within the herpes virus, adenovirus, pox, and papillomavirus families. Serological and protein diagnostic confirmation is often complicated due to antigen conservation within viral genomes. There's a high degree of proteomic homology within this genus, which results in serum cross-reactivity and poor differentiation between individual species of DNA viruses. An effective immunodiagnostic requires highly specific, non-cross-reactive monoclonal antibodies to viral-specific antigens. Monoclonal DSV69 was identified against highly pathogenic double-stranded DNA viral species despite sharing high sequence homology, greater than 90%, with evolutionary-related species. DSV69 is a novel and specific hybridoma cell line developed in the 90s by limiting dilution methods. Due to the project limitations at the time, monoclonality and stability was not optimized. Both repeated cultures of static and roller were done over the years with varying sera and media compositions, but they led to poor quality control in the final product. Significant work has been pursued in the identification of new double-stranded DNA viruses and characterizing their genealogical relationship. DSV69 served as a tool to differentiate these new types of viruses. And to ensure that this monoclonal was truly specific to the viral species of interest, known as virus B species 4, we tested unrelated RNA and single-stranded DNA viral lysates, as well as double-stranded DNA viruses with high homology, both type A and type B species 1 through 3. These are all negative for reactivity with DSV69 by Immunoblot, which confirmed a high specificity for protein species 4. This is identified predominantly with a 15 kilodalton envelope protein in subsequent analysis. When originally identified, DSV69 was observed to bind to an approximately 15 kilodalton protein by Immunoblot under denaturing conditions. The proper conformational detection of this protein is essential since it exists in a complex with at least three other proteins on the envelope surface. The detection of the true structure was probed with native PAGE. This monoclonal is capable of detecting this form in the lysate and specifically with the recombinant ENV protein. Other DBV4 proteins and envelope proteins for species 2 were screened against DSV69 and found not to be immunoreactive. So this monoclonal was found specifically only for the envelope protein from DB4. To ensure specificity was due to differences in protein sequence and not an artifact caused by the expression system or alterations in the protein structure from the HIS tag, COS cells were transfected with clones of either DSB4 or DSB2 envelope protein or the anti-plasmid vector. Using the DSV69 monoclonal, we visualized immunofluorescence under microscopy, and specific binding was found to cells transfected only with the plasmid expressing DSB4 envelope protein. As further confirmation, real-time binding between the monoclonal and recombinant envelope protein was measured using label-free technology. Binding to the mobilized envelope protein was specific, with a strong rate of association and minimal dissociation of the monoclonal in solution. Monoclonals to other single-stranded DNA viruses did not have measurable binding and was comparable to background levels. Epitope mapping was achieved for this monoclonal binding site in the envelope protein by using overlapping peptides of 10 amino acids in length, and then walking through the sequence using ELISA. The epitope was shown to be linear and resides in the N-terminal region of the protein. This helps gain a better insight into mechanisms of the envelope protein complex. Importantly, the identification of this epitope peptide can serve as a screening tool for DSV69-like antibodies in clinical samples and as a positive control in diagnostic assays. The epitope peptides were tested by ELISA at two different quantities, as well as extended titration of the DSV69 antibody. High affinity binding was apparent at all concentrations tested. Another peptide was made to the aligned homologous sequence in the envelope protein from virus B species 2 and was found to be non-reactive. The difference in sequence between peptides was only two residues. Although these experiments show the unique specificity and sensitivity of DSV69, it is a high value placed on it in the development of a diagnostic for this virus type. Fortunately, cultures of this hybridoma have been historically problematic in terms of antibody yields. Production never reached greater than 3 milligrams per liter, and were often in the microgram per liter range, regardless of culture conditions or serum levels used. The quality of the purified IgGs was rarely uniform, and varying amounts of aggregation was observed between lots. So, as the project passed forward, there were both short-term R&D requirements for over 200 milligrams of antibody and long-term in vitro diagnostic pilot manufacture requirements upwards of 2 to 3 grams. These production demands required a radical change in our workflow, and the options included modification of culture conditions, cloning out the heavy and light chains into suitable expression systems, undergoing a new mouse immunization with the recombinant envelope protein or epitope peptide, or subclone using a new technology of the parental line. We decided that the subclone option was the best path forward. The ClonePic technology was attractive to our improvement and rescue of this line. We could identify the rare populations of cells that were secreting IgG at acceptable levels without modifying the genetics or immunological properties of the antibody. Ideally, this high-throughput screening methodology could facilitate higher-producing stable clones from the low-producing parental line. Since DSV69 was developed by limiting dilution cloning, the monoclonality status was uncertain. This process now would provide that assurance. The workflow consists of individual hybridoma colonies being grown in suspended methyl cellulose matrix supplemented with media components. Colonies are derived from single-cell clones plated several days prior. As IgG is secreted from the colony, a complex is formed with a clone detect reagent. This forms a precipitate around the colony, indicating levels of secretion or presence of monoclonal antibody on the surface. These can be visualized by fluorescent detection and quantitated. Secondly, the second image on the top right is a white light image of precipitated antibody sequestered around a growing hybridoma clone as viewed under a microscope. Moving downward is FITC detection of a colony secreting IgG. The ClonePic software is capable of high throughput detection and selection of acceptable target clones. And lastly, the ClonePic facilitates automated picking and transfer of isolated target clones to destination plates with a robotic picking head. The experimental design of this project is listed. Hybridoma line DSB69 was plated at 200 cells per mil and 6-well plates of clone media. Fluorescently conjugated clone detect agent was incorporated in for the in-situ detection of secreted IgG. Colonies were then imaged by both white light at 150 millisecond exposure and fluorescence at 500 milliseconds. These signals that were evaluated and the parameters were established to optimize selection of clonal cells showing the highest secretion of IgG and then ranked by some total intensity of fluorescence. The goal here was to rescue a more stable DSV69 line by subcloning those highest titer antibodies and be able to increase antibody expression from the parental hybridoma line. So cells here were adapted and expanded in a static culture where they showed high viability and maximum rate of growth. They were plated and imaged after 7 days on the clone picks. This white light image shows cells plated at an ideal density for picking, and a wide variety of colony sizes are observed. This is indicative of individual growth rates for cells, which we have found to be typical for non-optimized hybridoma lines. The same quadrant on the plate was imaged for FIT-C emission. The difference in fluorescence intensities and halo size indicates different rates of IgG secretion. Many colonies show little to no fluorescence. This confirms our suspicion about the line, that a subpopulation is responsible for the majority of IgG production, which we calculated below 10%. Another observation was that secreting colonies were small, between 40 to 60 cells, versus the larger, faster-growing clones, between 70 to 150 cells, that were found to be negative secretors. These observations are quite apparent in the composite software feature, where heterogeneity in colony size and level of secretion can be visualized. We have found this feature useful when performing quality control checks for all our hybridomas entering production. Often this leads to our focus on a particular colony with fluorescence and size properties that are favorable for subcloning. The colony in the center field will be our focus moving forward. This colony was assigned an identification number of 685 and noted by the dotted circle. In the field from the imaging run, 5 colonies met the final acceptance criteria and are colored blue in the composite image. In all, 3,500 colonies were imaged from 6-well plates, and a combined 480 FIT-C IgG-positive colonies were picked into 596-well plates. This represents only 14% of the total population of parental clones screened. The colony can be clicked on the white light or FIT-C imaging tabs, and the output results window is displayed with all the statistics for that individual colony. Primarily, this allows us to convert the colony identifier to the well location, which will serve in its future reference. Colony 685 was deposited into plate 2, well A9. So, therefore, clone 2A9 can be evaluated for colony parameters associated with FIT-C intensity, white light intensity, morphology, and general information for original coordinates and deposit. The scatter plot here can help visualize how a colony of interest measures up to all image colonies on the plate. The selection criteria here is sum total intensity of fluorescence, and the colony of interest position can be resolved among 1,200 colonies from among the total 3,500 that were imaged. Each number colony is color-coded according to feature group and plotted against FIT-C signal. The majority of colonies have levels below the 100,000 unit cutoff, while the blue accepted colonies fall between 200 to 400,000 units. Colony 685 is annotated in yellow and has an intensity greater than the majority of accepted colonies. We use the scatter graph to plot the high FIT-C colonies in a different way, showing that the monoclonal antibody secretion profile. The sum total intensity was plotted on the x-axis. The FIT-C exterior total intensity, which is a measure of the total intensity outside the colony and within the local vicinity, was plotted on the y-axis. This is a direct measure of IgG secretion from the cells and it's also a good predictor that the monoclonal will be produced in culture. A linear correlation exists between these two parameters, and colony 685, noted in yellow, falls in the upper portion of this linear relationship. Viable high IgG secreting clones were further assessed for growth properties using the ClonSelect imager technology. We found CSI to be an effective tool when paired with the ClonePic during a stage where we had limited understanding of growth rates. We can now rank and prioritize clones for downstream development using this level of automation. In this model, deposited colonies are in a 96-well destination plate were able to be counted, and they were often variable in number. The CSI was used to count individual wells displaying confluence and cell number while cells recovered at different rates. This was repeated over several days in culture, and the growth curve was established for each of the colonies. We could then categorize the clones based on rate of growth. So before we entered the ELISA peptide screen for measuring antibody levels from the selected clones, we employed CSI to survey growth and eliminate slow-growing clones from the process. This allowed us to focus on only those clones predicted to work best in our culture system. The 480 high 60 clones were picked and deposited into 596 well destination plates containing 200 microliters of recovery media. They expanded for 5 days, and then CSI imaged them daily from the destination plates. This permitted objective and quantitative measurement of growth. In the past, we did this by eye and noted slow growers, but we found this to be inaccurate and taxing in the laboratorians. The imaging speed with CSI was less than 90 seconds for a single 96 well plate. We can now rapidly evaluate clone growth and rank the clones for the best proliferators. This was done prior to further assays so that superior growers were isolated. The image analysis here is from a subset of the monitor picks and qualitatively shows confluence for each well. The visual display of cell growth was converted to percent confluence, and further analysis provided an estimation of cell number for each well. CSI was useful in distinguishing clones that had nearly identical clone picks properties, such as 2H12 and 2A9. Yet significant differences in growth rates once adopted into liquid media were identified. The nearly fourfold higher growth rate of 2A9 over 2H12 led to removal of this clone for further screening. The cell counts from each well gave us the opportunity to normalize signals in the ELISA and prevent outliers, which could result from fewer cells available to secrete IgG. So the 146 top growers we identified were screened for DSV69 antibody by ELISA. The epitope peptide was demonstrated to be a good surrogate for the recombinant envelope protein and was used to screen supernames moving forward. Biosimulated peptide was loaded on strip avidin-coated wells, followed by the addition of diluted hybridoma supernames to measure specific IgG levels. Seen here, clone 2A9 and another notable clone 2C12 in yellow and 5 others were ranked as the top binders and were chosen for expansion and preservation. Next, we wanted to show how the initial FIT-C values off ClonePic could be tied to antigen-specific ELISA. Scatterplot analysis here shows a linear relationship between sum total intensity and the ELISA values from the clones. This again suggests that if a clone is secreting an IgG properly, it can be monitored in the matrix, isolated, and then validated by the ELISA, assuming that the clones adapted well in media. This analysis also confirms we had a heterogeneous population of secretors in the parent line, and a majority of the clones were growing without IgG production. 2A9 and 2C12 are colored in yellow and are among the top secreting clones. We wanted to then visualize the shift in monoclonal secretion with the 2A9 subclone in a replating experiment. This would further validate the ELISA and provide further confidence before dedicating this clone into large-scale production. 2A9 was expanded and showed high viability and growth rates in culture. It was then plated at 100 cells per mil, imaged, and picked at day 6. Colony sizes here were more uniform as compared to the parent plate and suggested similar growth rates, which is typical for optimized hybridoma lines. The same quadrant on the plate was imaged for FIT-C signal. The strong uniform pattern in fluorescent intensities and halo sizes indicated a similar level of IgG secretion. Nearly all colonies showed fluorescence. This confirms the successful recloning of DSV69 into a stable hybridoma line. Statistics were pulled for the top colonies from the 2A9 subclone. Highlighted in yellow are the top two secretors by some total intensity of fluorescence. They are ranked as the top clones for exterior total intensity by a wide margin. By scatter plot, there was a significant improvement in FIT-C signal after subcloning. Colonies from the 2A9 subclone compared to the parental clone on the left were plotted. The top clones are shifted towards the upper quadrants of the total intensity exterior intensity ratio box. There are now clones which are outside of this boundary on the right side, indicating higher performance characteristics than had ever been seen before. The FIT-C signals before and after subcloning are noticeable when compared side by side. For production analysis, 2A9 and the top subclones were expanded in culture, followed by analysis in banking. Cultures were maintained under identical grower bottle and media sera conditions to directly compare. Five subclones were preserved for future reference studies, and the two highest binding clones, 2A9 and 2C12, by peptide ELISA, were committed into 2-liter cultures. IgG was purified and analyzed in parallel with the parental IgG DSV69. 2-liter cultures were purified by standard protein G-affinity chromatography and quantitated by different assays. Both subclones showed a dramatic improvement between 17 to 25 milligrams per liter over historic yields of the parent clone, which were generally less than 1 milligram per liter. These yields were reproducible in larger cultures, which enabled us to attain the 200 milligram deliverable for the project. SDS page on the left indicated clear heavy and light chain bands, no modifications to the light chain, and lack of degradation products. Molecular determination by size exclusion shared sharp peaks for 2A9, indicative of a uniformly structured IgG. So, ClonePic technology rescued an established low-yield hybridoma line with clone matrix and clone detect, facilitating isolation of high-secreting clones. But the timeline and quality of screened hybridoma subclones were improved. This avoided time-consuming and extreme measures in order to re-derive the line if necessary. ClonePic's data suggested the poor production capacity of the parent clone was due to a small subpopulation of antibody-producing cells. The incorporation of the ClonePic imager post-picking was advantageous in monitoring growth and identifying poorly adapting clones. This allowed normalization of growth to directly compare IgG levels between clones in ELISA and then select away slow-growing clones that could slow production time. High-affinity subclones, 2A9 and 2C12, were capable of significantly higher antibody production capacity compared to historically lower yields with the parental line. These technologies achieved the development of a critical reagent for a novel diagnostic and clinical detection of a specific viral species. So for our next project, the development of antibodies to a bacterial chaperone known as DEG-P, I'm going to give you some background about this project. Protein chaperone DEG-P has been identified as a virulence factor in a number of bacterial diseases caused by E. coli, Salmonella, Haemophilus influenza, and other bacterial species. The stress response protein DEG-P is essential for organism survival at elevated temperatures by reducing cellular accumulation of misfolded proteins. Recombinant DEG-P protein is found to be highly immunogenic in animal models and mediates protection from bacteremia and associated inflammation under immunization protocols. High sigmoid homology, often greater than 90% between DEG-P of E. coli and Salmonella, although are quite similar, but orthologs from other bacterial species have divergence that can be exploited for diagnostic and therapeutic indications. We immunized mice with a DEG-P orthologue from pathogenic bacteria associated with a chronic inflammation in order to generate a novel and diverse panel of high-affinity monoclonal antibodies. Using the ClonePic, the isolation of hybridoma clones with different specificities was pursued in order to generate building blocks for immunodiagnostic development. The detection of this antigen in human sera early in the infection is critical, given the need for an early response test independent of serology. So following an immunization schedule, brains were harvested and B cells isolated. The development of unique hybridomas to recombinant dead T was achieved through screening tens of thousands of fused B cells. Large numbers of clones were observed expanding shortly after fusion in both liquid phase and matrix, which appeared to support sufficient growth of substantial hybridoma populations. Hybridomas were recovered for 2 days and then plated in semi-solid. Hack selection continued throughout the solidification of matrix and the establishment of colonies. Daily images of the plate were taken by light microscope, independent of the clone picks. The establishment of well-formed colonies was apparent leading up to day 7 of picking. Preliminary ELISA from the liquid phase clones indicated that we had a large number of parental clones strongly reacting against the immunizing antigen. We then proceeded with the high-throughput selection capability of the clone picks to discover antibody-secreting hybridoma clones reactive to DEG-T. Here, plated cells were imaged after 7 days. The white light field shows clones of differing colony sizes as expected from a plated fusion with countless hybridoma populations present. Hybridomas showed high viability, while the majority of unfused B cells of myelomas were non-viable. The same quadrant on the plate was imaged by FIT-C signal. Many colonies were positive with differing levels of IgG secretion. This is a much more complex picture as compared to the clonal line of the previous project. Since a large number of colonies grew briefly and died soon after plating, there was residual fluorescence that had to be deconvoluted from the viable colonies actively secreting. These may be dead colonies or viable ones exhibiting no fluorescence. Again, these observations are apparent with the composite feature of the software, where heterogeneity of both colony size and level of secretion can be visualized. We have found this feature useful after a fusion to ensure sufficient numbers of viable IgG-secreting clones have survived the process after fusion and plating. We will focus again on a particular colony with fluorescent and size properties that were appealing for picking. Nearly 7,000 colonies were screened and assigned to groups. Most were excluded based on low FIT-C signal as well as proximity and size issues. 479 met acceptance criteria and were picked into 5 96-well plates with recovery media. One of the accepted and picked colonies is detected in a circular dotted line here in color blue for the acceptance group. It progressed into a clone for development after assay screening. This colony was assigned an identification number of 5,000 and can be compared to surrounding colonies that are color-coded from their feature groups. All imaged colonies are displayed from this particular quadrant of the signal well plate. Only 6 colonies here met the final acceptance criteria and are colored blue. This color-coding feature made it easy for us to follow the software's rationale when assigning groups. In the case of colony 4968 up at the top center, the close proximity to nearby colonies will prohibit picking of monoclonal cells. For colony 5008 at the center right, the vertical elongation or axis ratio and irregular shape may indicate 2 colonies that have been growing into one another. So under greater magnification by FIT-C excitation, colony 5000 has the appearance of strong internal fluorescence and a halo of precipitated antibody radiating throughout the matrix. A useful feature to users of the ClonePic software is the distinction between viable colonies, dead colonies, and non-specific fluorescence. In this case, the small fluorescent object to the lower left of our colony of interest was judged to be non-specific precipitation and was not identified as a colony under white light, which would have surely been filtered as a proximity issue. The colony can be clicked on in the white light or FIT-C imaging tab, and the output results window is displayed with all the statistics for that individual colony. First, this allows us to convert the colony identifier to the well location, which will serve in its future reference. Colony 5000 was deposited into plate 1, well C9. Thus, clone 1C9 can be evaluated for colony parameters associated with FIT-C intensity, white light intensity, morphology, and general information for original coordinates and deposit. The colony was also evaluated in the statistics results window for comparing all the individual statistics of the image colonies. Here's a listing of the top 50 picked colonies ranked by FIT-C sum total intensity. 1C9 ranked as the 18th most FIT-C intense clone, as highlighted in yellow. This feature was important when accounting for the destination of colonies into multiple 96-well plates and comparing colony properties with screening data downstream for the selection of high-value clones. The scatter plot was used again for this project to visualize sum total intensity fluorescence. Here, the position of 1C9 was resolved among a significantly greater number of colonies, 2,000 in this case. The majority of colonies had FITC levels below the 50,000 unit cutoff, while the scattering of blue-accepted colonies mostly fall below 200,000 units. Colonies above this signal are mostly edge-excluded in red and have high signals that are an artifact of reflection close to the plate's edge. Colony 5,000, or 1C9, is annotated and has an intensity greater than the majority of accepted colonies. ELISAs with the recombinant DEGP protein were done on culture supernatants from all 480 pick colonies. The ClonePic rankings provided a definite enrichment of IgG secretors, which were specific to our antigen. Those clones with absorbent units above 1 were expanded and retested for association rates by label-free protein binding. 7 clones with the highest ranking and viability are noted in the ELISA chart and were committed to small-scale cultures for further source of Hybridoma supernatant. The 1C9 is labeled in yellow on the left and was among the highest ELISA signals in the first screen. The sum total intensity ranking was predictive of sufficient IgG levels to rank high in subsequent screens. The supernatants from the top clones in development were then tested for binding to the DEGT antigen on immunoblot. Robust protection was observed for all the clones, suggesting the antibodies had a preference for a linear epitope. Given the use of diluted supernatants, we were confident that these clones were secreting sufficient levels of IgG for downstream production. But still, we needed the assurance of monoclonality, as well as an optimized Hybridoma line to avoid complications like we have seen with the DSV69. The 1C9 was expanded and showed high viability and growth rates in static culture. Cells were plated at 100 cells per mil, imaged, and picked at day 7. Colony sizes were more uniform as compared to the parent fusion plate and are suggestive of similar growth rates. There was few, if any, dead cells, and there was an absence of cell debris seen previously. The same quadrant on this plate was imaged for FITC signal. The strong uniform pattern of fluorescent intensities and halo size indicates homogeneous IgG secretion. Nearly all colonies show fluorescence. This suggests that the 1C9 picked from the fusion plate was likely a stable monoclonal Hybridoma line. This offered us the opportunity to select the highest secretors for optimal yields of IgG downstream in production. The composite software feature does illustrate differences in secretion level, which is difficult to visualize alone in the FITC image. The colony was assigned identification number of 781 and noted by the dotted circle. In the field from this imaging run, 5 colonies met the final acceptance criteria and are colored blue in the composite image. In all, 870 colonies were imaged from 1/2 of a 6-well plate and a 44 FITC IgG positive clones were picked into a single 96-well plate. This represents only 5% of the total population of parental clone screen. Colony 781 was designated as 1C9 1B5. The statistics for half of the 44 pick subclones were pulled. The top subclones chosen for production are highlighted in yellow. To gauge improvement between 1C9 parent and the subclones, the top 5 subclones were averaged in FITC signals by total sum, exterior total, and interior total intensity. An improvement in the subclone group by 30% in sum total intensity was measured, but nearly a 50% increase was seen by exterior intensity. This suggests that these clones were more fastidious secretors from the average parent population that we had found. This was apparent when our production cultures yielded an average of 50 milligrams per liter for these 1C9 subclones. Some cloning was then performed on the other 3 high-value clones from the parent plate. High FITC intensity was seen for all reclones, and yields were more than sufficient for downstream applications. This provided us enough pure IgG material for subsequent characterization and assay development. We characterized the 6 high-value clones by ELISA to measure differences in epitope specificity. Bioattenuated JP was coded to a plate, blocked, and each of the clones and a non-specific control IgG were bound to antigen in a primary association step. Following washing, a single IgG clone was bound to each of the antibody-bound wells in a secondary binding step. Cooperative binding with the two monoclonal antibodies to the antigen could be measured, as well as a competition event, which is colored in red. The collective data for all anti-JP clones is summarized in the binning chart, where competitive antibodies are placed in defined epitope categories. From the cloning process, we had at least three different monoclonal antibody specificities to build new assays. In summary, ClonePic technology enables the selection of novel hybridoma lines from a fresh fusion of B cells immunized with JP chaperone protein from a pathogenic bacterial strain. The early selection of high-value anti-JP clones was possible with the automated detection and selection capabilities of this technology. The high-affinity subclones 1C9 and 5 others were identified and selected, translating to higher antibody production capacities up to 50 mg per liter than we had seen before. ClonePic technology facilitated the discovery of novel and unique IgG reagents and the development of in vitro diagnostics and therapeutics against the virulence factor from this pathogen. I'd like to thank you very much today for listening to this presentation. And at this point, we can begin to field questions that you submit. Thank you.
Thank you for joining today. We appreciate your time.